subtitle, a very long subtitle that began as our title, which is Actually Existing Capitalism and the Generalization of the Proletariat. That was a little bit of a mouthful for people to even think of what they were going to, so we made it what it is, the 21st century class struggles. I am really pleased to introduce, many of you know, all three of these people, Kasembe Balogun, former executive director, was one of the staff people, a programming director at the Breck Forum, currently working with the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation. Roz Moshe, a frequent contributor of music, ideas, great ideas here at the Marxist Education Project. Lewis Gordon, author of the most recently of What Fanon Said, delivered a very moving room, a packed room lecture in April, I think it was. They're here to improvise, Marxologize, and get us going with our current summer intensive. We're getting off to a bit of a late start, so I'm passing it off to the three of you guys. Improv away.
All right, thank you, Michael. And how's everyone feeling out there?
Good.
It's good to see everybody. As Michael mentioned, my name is Kasembe Balogun. I'm the former director of education and programming at the Breck Forum. I'm happy to be back in this new incarnation, the New York, the Marxist Education Project / New York Marxist School. And I want to welcome everyone here just the start of the, I guess it's the second Marxist intensive since last year. You know, I think everyone's going to be in for a real treat for the next three and a half days. I'll just say a few words about the kind of thinking around the making of this this panel, and then I'm going to turn it over with a couple questions, and you know, kind of do an open style interview style question. But I guess part of my thinking came out of three different areas. One was that one is you know, a critical reading of Marx's theses on Feuerbach, you know, where he says that he's the last portion. He says that the point of philosophy is not to interpret the world, but to change it. And when I was thinking about reading that particular text and what he was going through, one of the biggest things that came out for me was the idea that, you know, history is matter, right? History is the stuff that really moves and grooves and is part of, you know, the fabric of our everyday existence. But history is not something that's outside of us, but it's something that's between us, that we shape, you know, in a social sense, in the social setting. You know, and I appreciated that in thinking about that, because, you know, when, you know, oftentimes when, you know, we engage in this activist work, you know, the problems of the world feel so, the problems of the world feel so overwhelming. And we kind of forget that, you know, these are human conditions and they can be altered, they can be mutated. You know, so starting from the first jump, that history matters. The second thing I was thinking about is the whole question of austerity and the question of precarity. You know, it seems that, you know, one of the things that, you know, Marx also said is that all the solid melts into the air. And it feels like in this particular time, we're in the economic crisis that we're in, that, you know, the ground in which we're standing on in terms of what we consider like nation, you know, our own personal job situations, our relationships, the ways in which we identify ourselves is consistently in motion and consistently in change. And part of like, you know, part of, I guess to borrow, you know, Lewis will talk about it more, but part of like the lived experience of being black and being black, being working class for myself has always been one of like challenging and rethinking the ways in which I'm positioned in instability and how I can reclaim agency in that. And so the way in which I, you know, in a specific way approach change is one of like consistently shifting and thinking about change in different ways and reacting to it, you know, and developing a sense of a rhythm. And I'm thinking about that in terms of like the ways in which, you know, in thinking about that in terms of improvisation and things of ways in which I can actually engage in ideas of agency and change. The third thing is just thinking about like what's currently happening in our Black Lives Matter, this Black Lives Matter moment that we're living in, and the ways in which the Black Lives Matter movement has not only altered the way we look at things like social media, but also the way we look at protest. Last year, when I was in City Hall Park for a demonstration, and standing, you know, in a crowd of people, a lot of them who I didn't know, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, we just started moving. Now I've been involved in the left for 20 years, and usually there's a speech, there's a setting off, there's an explanation, there's people leading a chant, but in this case, people just moved. And they seem to move up and down the street, you know, like in a way that had rhythm, but I wasn't exactly sure where we were going, but I just had to like trust in the gut of where we were actually going, where we were gonna be ending up. And kind of like being in that situation of like giving myself up to this collective process, you know, in the middle of this, and then challenging oftentimes the kind of rules that are oftentimes set into motion of our protest. Thinking about that, you know, it had me thinking about the ways in which how can we incorporate these ideas into our living beings, into our organization. Me, Ross and myself have known each other for a number of years, and I've known Lewis. He's been on the stage many of times at the Old Breakfast Room, but also recently, as Michael mentioned, for his new book, what Fanon said. And one of the things I always noticed is that, you know, there was a kinetic spirit between the music that was happening on stage at the Brecht in terms of Ross as a curator and what I was thinking about in terms of what the activism was in a particular period of time. And what we realized is that we both wanted freedom. Everyone wants liberation, right? And like the ways in which we think about music at times, what I found in terms of my Marxism, in terms of my philosophy, I'm thinking more and more musically. And so that being said, I was like, well, what does Marxism say about improvisation? What does Marxism say about change? What does Marxism say about wanting to think about these things in not necessarily a very staid way, but a way that really kind of expands our notion and expands our vocabulary? So, you know, that being said, thinking about that, wanting to do that, I really wanted to get the Ross and Lewis, who are experts in terms of thinking about freedom, thinking about change, thinking about philosophy, all these different things, to kick us off in terms of this conversation, you know, and so we can also participate, and also you too, as well, in terms of this as a jam session. You know, I'll just leave it at this, you know. Miles often said, in the second quartet, you know, it's about time, not changes. I want us to think about what does it mean to think about radical performance, but also radical listening, right? And how do we play off each other? So with that said, I want to kind of kick it off and then just allow us to give us a sense of openness. And I just want to kick a question to both to you two, is that in your particular work, you know, where do you see the art of improvisation coming in, and how does that strengthen your work and the ways in which you think about the world and how you think about your radical activism? Who wants to take that first?
Yeah, thanks Kazembe, and thanks for all your work down through the years and to the Brecht Forum, New York Marxist School in general. I'm a Marxist, I'm from Brooklyn. I used to have these intense conversations sometimes with my father, who was a staunch nationalist, even though he changed before he passed last year. You know, life will do that, you start to assess things. But I'm also a jazz musician. My father was a jazz musician as well. And, you know, the transformation of the means that exist is sort of what encapsulates what jazz is about in general. To me, probably most especially to what I gravitated to, which is probably jazz in its later stages, which got called avant-garde or free jazz, which I'm very proud to be part of. I kind of have a problem with the terms, in a way, because avant-garde seems to be just a generic terminology for musicians who are doing music without boundaries or not playing other people's ideas, but that doesn't mean there's a sameness of approach, even if what you're doing is very different. I mean, you can't get around using the terminology sometimes to let people know what you're playing, because you know people identify with the different names that have been put on the different stages of jazz's evolution. But I see what I do musically within that realm is very intertwined with what Marx was talking about, that dialectic of changing what is what exists and transforming it to make something new. But even if some things have to be dealt away with permanently, too, maybe, you know. Sometimes, a lot of times, I play music without composition. And but a form imposes itself anyway, based on the musicianship of the people playing, or if people are really listening, a cohesion can develop, even if there's not a preset makeup of chord changes or chord sequences. And what Kazembe just said about what he witnessed in the demonstration, that's so true. Every time I come to these, all the rallies and demonstrations that's been happening, it just kind of reinforces the nature of jazz to me, or specifically free jazz, as they say. When people can coalesce, it might not be specifically coming from a top-down approach in that regard, but a form does develop based on the interaction of the people and the willingness of the people to be together and deal with a central idea, which is important. You know, improvisation doesn't always mean random, and I'm sure, you know, everyone here knows it's the same politically, like that.
Oh, I think I have one. You can hear me fine.
Sorry. Oh, I have one too, sorry.
It's recording?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, I see.
Okay.
Yeah,
well, oh, this is for the recording. I see. Yeah. Well, good afternoon, everybody.
We're live streaming.
You're live streaming, I see, so they could hear me. Well, the first thing is that I'm here in a two-part capacity. I'm part of the 7:30 p.m. Discussion, and Michael mentioned there's a 4:30 discussion that's dealing with improvisation, and I said, yeah, I'm down with coming down for that. And that's for a variety of reasons. Some of you who know anything a little bit about me may know that I'm also a musician. Some who didn't just found out.
Yeah.
And, But the thing is, my main instrument actually is drums. I play a variety of instruments. And there are times I feel more piano and I play more piano. Mm-hmm. And we're fortunate the piano is here. Now, one of the things that's very funny, I'm going to bring up just to start things off, which is related to what Kazembe said. What's funny when you play particularly jazz, it actually is in all music forms, but a lot of people don't realize this until they play jazz. Whenever I would go somewhere and an instrument is there, people always say the same thing when I, you know, pop up, and if I mention I play an instrument, they'll say, oh, but I don't think the piano is in tune. Okay? Now, I always say the same thing. Don't worry about it. and then they look, they're like, what do you mean don't worry about it? Now, the interesting thing, of course, is what a musician knows is that a lot of the instruments we play, and a lot of the music that's written is in a specially circumscribed terrain of music. But the human capacity to hear or to experience exceeds that terrain. And as a consequence, if you're playing, for instance, the piano, you can, now the piano is set up in half tones, but if you're on a string instrument, you could hit the quarter tones. And when you try to do in a piano is to simulate that, you can actually do what's called dissonant sounds. Now, the reason this is important is, you see, a person who's not a good musician, even if it's a perfectly tuned piano, is not going to play music. Because that person is trying to force on the moment something that takes it out of its communicative practice. Whereas a person who's an excellent musician knows it doesn't have to be in tune. Because what you could do is make music out of the dissonance. You see? And this is what someone like Thelonious Monk was doing. Thelonious Monk, he could perfectly well play, you know, what people consider the more harmonious, soft-sounding piano. But what you hear with Monk, that those dissonance, those clangs, he was doing that on purpose, precisely because life isn't a neat continuum. And so if you're doing music, if you're performing music that is connected more to life, you need to think about the sounds that come, as we could say, in political language, from the periphery. Okay? Now, this becomes very crucial because it means if you have that attitude towards music, it means you never walk into a musical situation worried. Because you're not predetermining the outcome. You're actually entering a music situation open to the possibility. Now, this is crucial in another way, because you see, what's interesting when jazz musicians play, what's fascinating about jazz is you can get any jazz musician from any part of the world. It doesn't matter where she or he is from. You don't even have to announce what the tune is. You could count off and just say play, and they will start playing and figure out music from there. The reason they could do this is because they're paying attention to each other and responding to what is being articulated. This means then that implicit in jazz, and it actually pertains to all music, but I'm using jazz as a metaphor here, is that the you know that point in the thesis on Feuerbach about changing it? People fail to understand that there's a form of interpretation and communication that's done in the process of making things. So whenever you meet, the music for jazz is not actually the pre-given, say, basic melody for a song, because you could play any song in different meters. I could even demonstrate a piano, but you could play it also in different keys. You could also play it in layers. This is something that Bach understood in his conceptions of fugue. And it's also what a lot of jazz musicians brought to it. Now, the reason this is important is because it flies in the face of a particular conception of a human being that dominated the emergence of Euro-modern capitalism. Euro-modern capitalism emerged with the conception of the human being that's already in a kind of atomic motion in which force hits force. I'm talking about Hobbesianism.
Yeah.
And that within it, you have the notion of looking at reason as trying to decode the rational principles in advance. And so some people, especially when we talk about improvisation and Marxism, make the mistake of bringing that model of science into a Marxist framework. If you bring that model of science into a Marxist framework, then there is only one way to perform. It means, for instance, the philosophical anthropology you have is going to be one in which human beings cannot be contingent, cannot be unpredictable, and their unpredictability becomes a problem. You see? Now think about it. If a jazz musician went to play with other jazz musicians and say, your unpredictability is a problem, the music won't groove. It won't happen. So in effect, you have a paradox in musical performance, which is without the advance of things happening, a collective can actually create a simultaneous performance, which is a lot like what you were talking about walking down the street. Now, this is crucial because, you see, one of the things we know about Marxism, people could debate whether it's early Marx, later Marx. They could debate whether you're talking about Marx as a structuralist. You could debate whether you're talking about Marxism. Is it dialectical science? Is it positivism? You could go through all of those things. But there's one thing you absolutely know about Marxism. Marxism is against alienation. That's what it's all said. You know, if you're going to have a Marxism that alienates people, something's wrong. Okay? Now, this becomes very crucial. Because, you see, if Marxism is against alienation, and if a form of alienation is the eradication of human agency, then logically, Marxism must be against that which impedes human agency. So that means models of Marxism that close off the creative potential of people would function as patently against the premises of Marxism. That means then, if you see Marxism as an effort to open up the possibility, then you could now see why so many jazz musicians were reading Marx. That's open. I don't, you know, we'll move it through.
No, I was affirming.
and that's interesting because, like, I was just like, because part of what, that comes out of this too, and is also the question of, like, the role of jazz in terms of the Pacific, like, Afro-diasporic experience of us as what we bring to it in terms of our experience, in terms of layering in human agency. I appreciate what you said about jazz musicians reading Marx, because I feel like that's a part that we don't talk about. I grew up on 155th Street and 8th Avenue, and I was just reflecting on the fact that right on the corner was the old Rockland Palace that Charlie Parker actually played a benefit for the Young Communist League there in 1946. And Dizzy Gillespie always, did a lot of work around that. You watch the new Nina Simone documentary that's on Netflix, and she talks about, hanging out with Lorraine Hansberry and talking about, they had conversations around Marx, Lenin, and revolution. You know, and anybody who hasn't seen that documentary, how many people have seen the documentary? You gotta see the documentary. Nina Simone is on Netflix, is amazing. But I think part of it is also just thinking about the ways in which operalizing and thinking about change. Amei Baraka has this great essay in Blues People called "The Changing Same," where he's linking, gospel, blues, free jazz into one continuum, in terms of the ways in which we can open up a space for both the sacred and the profane, opening up the space for ideas of commune and church being anywhere in which those particular elements of fire are performed. And I feel sometimes that in that space runs up sometimes against, the ways in which we oftentimes see space as well. And I'm just thinking out loud here, just thinking about, like, the communing, the necessity for church in the midst of running for freedom, as an escaped slave, and being in the woods and having to find immediate commune in that process. You know, so I guess part of it too is like how are we layering and thinking about space as well, I guess, in terms of the ways in which we're thinking about improvisation, because that also runs up against like, you know, where ideas of radicalness actually occur, you know, and you know, and I guess part of the democratization is part of thinking about it that happens in process where you're at in a particular moment.
Yeah, I agree, you know, about the correlation. You just said, you know, it's definitely there. And Baraka's article that you mentioned, his essay that ended up in the Black Music book, just was the totality of so much. I guess he was saying is that the same kind of revolutionary intent is a thread that's running through music, Black music of different genres, in music in general, that even on a technical basis, some of the musical techniques in jazz or free jazz are coming out of that spiritual dynamic of the Black church. That I witnessed myself growing up in Brooklyn in my grandmother's church. Even before I could articulate, I would notice that when the congregation started speaking in tongues all at once, it sounded a lot like the late period Coltrane I was hearing in the house and Sun Ra and stuff. And I mean, the more I read and learned from people, I could articulate why it was like that. You know, but I think that that particular duality is not a contradiction, especially with the Black experience of the sacred and the what's called profane. For myself, I fell out with God concepts many years ago, but I still feel like a spiritual person. It's just not connected to a lot of the business as usual. But I understand, and I know Kazembe is a member of a church that's way more progressive and stuff, which is what we need more of. But jazz musicians have always been in that situation, that consciousness is there politically, yet that act of creation is not a contradiction with that. You know, I think that was recognized in a lot of Marxism as well, recognizing the cultural habits of people, trying to come to a central point of what you're trying to establish. And, you know, when I got a little older, I came across maybe some older ideas about art that's abstract, being, quote unquote, being hard for people to understand, which is, to me, is insulting, because that's like calling people stupid, you know? It's not so much about what you like or dislike, that's your right, you know? I've seen that too, people being very condescending if somebody expressed that they didn't like avant-garde music or anything, and that's just as bad too, to look down on people. Or to act, you know, more conscious than now because of what people like. I mean, I'm a lover of all kinds of music myself, even though my personal calling in music is probably coming from the more revolutionary area, jazz, but the whole thing is revolutionary. I never saw any contradiction with that. Because even within my own family, you know, there was a lot of, it's a refuge for people, especially Black people, you know, they were coming at these different concepts from different zones. And even the ones who radicalized it, you know, like my father, for instance, you know, I kind of saw it as, you know, the consciousness was there. But, you know, some people still have to hold on to certain things like that. which I don't think was too necessary for me in that regard. I would say, yes, the spiritual aspect's very important as far as living life and ethics and that. And that particular, what Professor Gordon accurately said a few seconds ago about that particular element that promotes alienation, I never gravitated to that too much. And a couple of times in conversations, the example of how certain abstract painters were funded by the CIA and those uncool sources back then. And I'm sure that was true. But my retort is always, okay, well, what does this have to do with creative music in general? You know, you can't, because the impetus for the development of the two is totally different, you know. I think that black musicians or American musicians in general who have avant-garde inclinations don't have this inclination via a cultural disconnect. Even if there are people like myself who got really immersed into reading Marx but didn't feel that he was alienated from the quote-unquote spiritual component because of it. Yeah. And that Baraka's article, The Changing Same, is very good. I'm glad you brought that up.
Well, I guess what I'm going to say connects also to your first question. It's funny, as Michael brought out, I had the unique privilege and honor of having my recent book celebrated here back in April. And it's a book called What Fanon Said. And this year, Fanon would have been 90. It was July 20th. And, you know, it's interesting. You know, when the book came out, I wanted to have a way in which I just thought it was right that one celebrates someone like Fanon in a context like this one. And it struck me, in the midst of all this, I forgot that 20 years ago, I wrote a book called Fanon and the Crisis of European Man. And in that book, it wasn't on Fanon, it was engaging his ideas to deal with themes similar to this one. One of the things when that book came out that was very interesting was that some reviewers had written about the book that when they read the book, it read to them. Thank you.
Thanks.
I'm sure. Yeah, we could just put it. Thank you, bro. It read to them, they said, like jazz. Yeah. They said they could see in the sentences and the words, and I said, well, that's because it is. And I bring that up because there is a way of thinking that is premised on disconnection. And that disconnected way of thinking deals with a form of compartmentalism that would say if you're writing a theoretical book, you have left yourself as a musician behind. Or if you're writing, or if you're performing as a musician, you have left yourself as a theorist or intellectual behind. However, what you leave behind is actually part of one of the critical things that Marxism was talking about. Because there is a conception of philosophical anthropology that basically says that the human being must be broken down analytically into subcategories that are then managed within an economy, not only in terms of, for instance, commodities, but also the way knowledge is distributed. However, if you see everything as interconnected, then not only don't you break it down that way, but you realize something rather paradoxical, which is that even when you bring all the connections together, it doesn't follow that the connections are complete. And it's precisely because you realize this incompleteness that one is able to deal with the question of what is to be built to reach out into the future. Now, this becomes crucial because you see, although, as we know, when you do say Marxism, you think about history. What a lot of people forget is that it is also a way of thinking that raises the question of the human being as facing a future. In other words, the human being is the animal that faces the question of what should I do? You see? If we stay stuck on what's happened, we can always create an act of dissociation to say, well, that was then. However, saying this is now doesn't mean the the task is over, because the future will be built on what is done now. Now, this relationality begins to raise some rather interesting questions. And I noticed them, if one gets to, for instance, political activism, there's one model of political activism that would like what I call epistemic foreclosure. You know, it was once advanced knowledge. So it's like the other kind of people who do music I talked about, right? They want everything mapped out. But there's another model in which the you know what the situation is, right? So what you see in terms of ideas, theory, if you look at what is a jazz performance? A jazz performance is actually a situation in which music occurs. You see what I'm getting at? Because even though you've heard the tune many times, when you go to a jazz performance, you expect to be surprised because even the musicians don't know what they're going to do this time. You see? And in a way, that's a metaphor for what happens if you don't have a straight-jacketed society. Because it means that the society is trying actually to build that which it doesn't know in advance. And people say, well, how would you know if it's working? Now, a jazz musician would have a very simple answer to that. It's working if it grooves. We know when a society isn't working, precisely because it becomes agonal, suffering, oppression. We could go down the list of the kind of things that are happening in a society that's not grooving. But the error people make is they think that a society that's grooving is a society in which conflicts have all been resolved. Mm-hmm. But you notice when I talked about jazz, I said it's not the elimination of dissonance. And so one comes into a different analysis of what is being created if one is going to take the notion of improvisation seriously. And I've always seen all liberation thought, whether it's Marxism, whether it's Africana philosophy, whether it's, and believe it or not, psychoanalysis is also a form of liberation thought, because it is about figuring out what you are doing to inhibit your capacity to flourish. And this is one of the reasons why, you see, the big error that's made in many theoretical models is to pit these against each other without seeing the fact that they're actually connected. Now, since we're talking a little about improvisation, I just got to bring this up.
Go ahead.
Okay. It's very funny. I've been playing. I didn't plan, actually, to. I used to do a lot of music. I used to be with Jazz Mobile and play with a lot of musicians. But with a lot of the writing and things I've been doing, I pretty much play at home with my children. And my son is a very gifted bassist, and we end up jamming in. He just decided he wants to gig. And so since I'm an old man, I'm older than I look. And my son is 13, going to be 14 this week. And I have a doctoral student. We decided we have this trio called Three Generations. And what's interesting is that we got together, and we're just playing this music, and I find myself suddenly in a lot of musical situations. And one of the things what's fascinating is to see the connectedness of generations meet. And I bring this up because although we're talking about jazz, there are many connectedness of generations that are important for movements. So for instance, I love, you know, I've written articles where I'm critical of certain dimensions of hip hop, and a lot of people don't understand that if you're going to take the time to write on something, sometimes it's because you dig it. And I wrote an essay called The Problem of Maturation in Hip Hop. And at first, it pissed off a lot of hip-hop people. And then they get older, and then they're like, yo, Lewis, you were right. And what it is this. What they began to realize is I didn't hate hip-hop. My argument was that all aesthetic productions, if they're going to be non-alienating, should have within them the capacity for growth. You see what I'm saying? If hip-hop or any art form, rock and roll, you name it, tells you for the rest of your life to be an adolescent, then you're going to be locked in a society at a level of basically being an adolescent consumer. And you will ultimately be a slave to a social system. And we know that happened with hip-hop. Because hip-hop had an opportunity to have a form of independent capital. Yeah. And they were all bought out by the larger companies. However, one of the things that's very interesting that relates to jazz and hip-hop, I love, this is the part I love most. I love freestyle. I love whenever I'm with a group of musicians and a hip-hop, you know, a rapper would come in and say, you know, can I, and that person starts rapping. What's interesting is what comes out. Because remember, that person didn't know what he or she was going to say till that moment. It's a lot like what happens when you have communities get together who are not locked at the level of purely a collective, but have the intersubjective moment of a social relationship. Mm-hmm. They produce music. Mm-hmm. And this is the part that a lot of people miss in terms of what if we're talking about improvisation and Marxism, we're talking about is that improvisation is not simply to be locked at the level of a collective, but to break down the dissociations that would inhibit a collective becoming a social relation. Mm-hmm. And this thing about sociality is a part that connects in to all kinds of other things, because as you know, sociality builds things. It builds meanings, it creates ideas. It also makes you realize that ideas don't come willy-nilly, but they come through the communication with each other. Yeah. And this brings us now to the part with jazz that connects a lot to democracy. Because you see, the problem is, if you look at the kind of, and I'm being critical of the Hobbesian model, because that dominates a lot of liberal political theory, it's I am myself, I have my interests, and you are yourself with your interests, and you're in the way of my interests unless I'm forced to work with you to get my interests. That's that old model, okay? And that model dominates the philosophical anthropology. Because you see, it now becomes, how do I figure out rationally to manipulate you to get what I want? Mm-hmm. However, the problem with that model is that one sometimes fails to realize that if you look at the jazz performance, if you use that model properly, all I want to do when I get on the stage as a jazz musician is do what? Get my solo. Do you see what I'm getting at? However, if you look at jazz performance, when another person is now soloing, it is the duty of every other musician to do what? To get that person to do her or his best performance. Do you see what I'm getting at? And it means each time, and it's not like a contract, you're actually doing it for the music. And this becomes very crucial because if you have this is what Marx was being critical of when he criticized bourgeois society. Because bourgeois society says it's for yourself. Mm-hmm. But if you're actually trying to create a society that actually flourishes, you see what I'm saying? Then it means that when people's talents are being manifested, your relationship to it is not to see that person as in the way of your ability to perform. You see your relationship to do what you can to get that person to perform her or his best.
Right.
So that means implicit in it is an interesting ethics of virtue that's not often paid attention to. Because you see, if you have a drum solo, if you have a piano, for instance, when you were playing your sax, mm-hmm. If I just started playing all kinds of piano stuff, I'm interfering with the performance. And what's lost is not only your solo or mine, but the music is lost. And so there is an interesting point where if one lets the self go, in other words, really to perform music, whether it's freestyle hip-hop, whether it's good rock and roll, whether it's jazz, requires letting oneself go to enable the sociality, the performance, to emerge.
Okay. Yeah, I'll make it brief. I'm sorry. That's true. Absolutely. And that's why I gravitated to jazz like that, because it was that example of support. Those situations where the person was just looking to come in and solo, that doesn't, that never really worked. You know, I don't like those kinds of situations where things are very egocentric. I mean, even within the context of so-called free jazz, where it might seem that it's random, you know, you still have to listen, even if you're not playing a standard tune, you know, because the early developments of jazz was the restructuring of the Tin Pan Alley tune or the Broadway show tune and creating new lines on top of those chord structures. And what came after in the late 50s and the 60s was seen as a break from that, but not necessarily. I mean, it is in a way, I think politically, you should play your own music just for socio-political reasons in that regard. But if the guidelines of the previous structures what helps you to develop, I don't think that you should deny that or say that, you know, you're being free if you don't know what you're being free from like that, you know. I mean, you know, the process of rebelling from something that that you don't know about, which I'm sort of saying what Professor Gordon already said, but I just had to agree, because I think you articulated it the best way. And I fell out with a lot of musical situations in that regard as a person that plays avant-garde music in a way, because I felt that cooperation wasn't there. The fact that we weren't using composition didn't bother me, or even if the rhythm was pretty open. But the listening does so much in the interaction with each other, how you, you know, to create the form, you know, and that model is parallel with the jazz model. What Marx basically was talking about in that regard, about trying to project a progressive exterior onto what's really alienation and saying somehow that's part of how we move forward. But it's a long time misnomer that things have to be inclusive. You know, you have these individual voices, but they are working together to make an ensemble statement.
Yeah, I appreciate that, and I think that's something that we're kind of like moving forward to. And I think part of my thinking in terms of listening to both of your great comments is like, how do we translate that into our political lives, even our social lives? Because I think part of it too is that, you know, obviously we've all been at that meeting when somebody's like, someone's talking and talking. I'm like, this motherfucker's soloing like a motherfucker. He won't shut the fuck up, you know, like, you know, and you know, and but then really like step back. One of the things I've really gathered from one of the person from a men's group that I participated in was that, you know, there's usually this thing in the meeting of saying, you know, step up, step back, you know, if you're someone who doesn't talk, step up, and if you're somebody who talks a lot, step back. And then the person remixed it and said, step up, step up. If you're someone who talks a lot, if you're someone who doesn't talk at all, speak up. And if you're somebody who does talk a lot, step up your listening skills. And part of, like, I think that kind of echo chamber a lot of times in terms of our organizational formations, our writing, you know, our thinking has to be a type of stepping up of our listening skills, right, and our understanding, which at times, you know, I like what you said, Ross, because I think that the form is oftentimes deceiving, mm-hmm. in terms of what real freedom is. We can talk about, like, we're living in the age of the internet, therefore we're free. But, you know, if we don't have the stepping up of the listening skills in terms of the ways in which we are trying to commune, or to use a hip-hop term, cipher, you know, then we're losing something, because even though we can have as much polyphonic rhythms out there, if it's not in that kind of conversational style, then we lose something, right? Which is why spaces like this are important. Well, speaking of which, I think, you know, what, maybe we can take a few questions from the audience. Mitch, you had your hand up?
Yeah, but I'll wait until somebody else has a question.
Oh, you're stepping up your listening skills. Anyone? We'll take some questions or some comments.
Could you please say your name when you...
My name is Daryl Prince. I agree with you a lot. I think of very specific people who get up and speak a lot. I can also have been accused of that from time to time. But I've also seen, like, I mean, there are certainly virtuoso performances where like, you know, somebody gets up and talk and you kind of want to incorporating those energies always feels like it's got to be a bit of a push and a pull, like, with that, because, you know, there's some folks who get up and talk for too long, and it's just this awful piece. But you know, and you want to embrace that, like, dynamic energy, that give and the take, and that flow that's not necessarily completely controlled. And, you know, like when you were saying about the ciphers, like the freestyles that come from the stuff that's not necessarily as practiced. But, you know, sometimes the practice is also very beautiful, and it's very strong, and it's something that people can immediately vibe to and resonate. So, I mean, I feel like I do feel like there's always kind of like a push and a pull with that particular. But and that was my only comment. I think I don't know how you balance that, because, I mean, you kind of went all the way towards like kind of a push and a pull, like, or the like collective, and then, but then there's also, you know, there are, I do feel like there are folks who, you know, you do want to hear in kind of their entirety. I don't know how you.
Can we hear some more? It'd be great to hear from a lot of you. And over here, and there.
I was really wondering if we're going to do any improvisation, like you said in the paper, because I think that helps to break people from being all intellectual and just wordy. So, Kazembe, that's directly for you.
My name's LaRose. I'm a student of Melissa's. So
close. Colleague.
Well, I think
she's got a new book out that kicks. It's fabulous.
Thank you.
It's, thank you. Before she says, let me just say, it's called Being Apart. And it brings together the question not only of Africana existentialism, right, in literature, but also she brings it together with questions that deal with Marxism, actually, in the way we're talking about today, because she looks through the ways in which innovation, creativity, from the thought of C.L.R. James, Fanon, Camus, Braithwaite, people like those, can be understood in terms of how not only the Black radical tradition, but the very question of how we deal with a philosophical anthropology that connects to the question of an open understanding of literature today. So we should here have a session on her book. Being Apart. It's published by the University of Virginia Press.
Heard of it.
Yeah, so that's a shout out for it. And we could talk about it. So mazel tov.
Thank you so much. That's Lewis. He's so generous. So thank you so much. My question though is for all of you as teachers, and because I teach as well. When you were talking about Marx and engaging with Marx in a way that not only dissipates alienation, but also addresses history as a living organism and the embodiment of humanity, how do you all sort of counter the narcissism of the millennial generation? When I say that, I mean it in the best, not the best sense, but in a critical sense, in that I was at one of the Black Lives Matter protests, the big one in DC in December, that Reverend Al was at and some of the others. And one of the most striking moments was when one of the young people, of the younger generation in the movement, was very upset, and rightfully so, because some of the elders who were there were telling them to step back, we need the platform. Ooh. And the young person, rightfully so, was indignant. However, her statement I thought was problematic. She said, we began this movement. Seeing history in isolation is exactly not a continuation of the liberation struggles that we all know about, but is this one pocket, this one incident that they began. So I'm wondering how all of you as teachers, you know, combat this sense of, you know, history and isolation and the narcissism of some of these young people who don't even know who Fannie Lou Hamer is. They don't even recognize that they're just, you know, younger iterations of people who've already come before. Do you know what I mean? So I'm just wondering how all of you as teachers deal with that and then link it to Marxism and everything we talk
about. We should get, let's get as many as possible. Because we could split them up.
Can you discuss more about the connection of the Communist Party of the 1930s and 40s with the jazz movement, such as bebop? I mean, I remember you mentioned about Charlie Parker. Well, that's Ross. I remember Ross mentioned that Charlie Parker actually performed a concert that is connected to the Communist Party. And that is significant. I think that's why I heard from you.
Yeah. I mean,
it's from. Oh, okay. I mean, that's very significant because that's what has not been said or mentioned nowadays. You know, since communism is such a bad word among Americans, well, particularly people in the United States. You know, as far as communism in this country and the arts of jazz all at the same time. I'd like you, if you could discuss a little more about that. I mean, it's very significant that you mentioned.
I know this, she had her hand up, and I guess you have, and over there.
Hi.
Hi.
My name's Liz Shanklin, and I was trained as an actor from the time I was about 7 years old. And I used to really, really love improvisation. And the way we would do it is you'd be given a character and a situation, and then you would start expressing yourself in those terms and imagining yourself in those conditions. And as I was listening to you, I wondered, because I'm exploring and researching on my own, I'm very concerned about the lack of empathy of large portions of the population. And I'm wondering what you think about improvisation as a way to address this with people who don't seem to have their human empathy operating. And if they took certain situation and so forth and began to improvise and draw from themselves their own experience in this imaginary situation, would that be helpful to us?
Yes. I forget Lisa.
Hello, I'm Fritzy. I guess, yeah, I'm really moved and interested in what you guys are talking about. I guess, like, one thing that I was thinking about was, I have 2 points. One is a connection I'm making and one is a question. The first is I've been thinking a lot about like science fiction as a tool for thinking creatively about social justice and like expanding the ways in which we think about possibility and imagination. And like a lot of what you all were saying about jazz, I saw a lot of connections with what I've been thinking about science fiction, which is a cool, interesting connection. Another thing that I was thinking about is like when I've been involved in like political organizing, there's a way in which like certain models are passed down, like this is how we run meetings, like this is how we plan an action, like these are the roles and like this is what we do. And the reason that those like trainings and like roles exist is because it's like, you know, they've been based on a lot of experience from the past. But at the same time, when we like just do the same thing again and again and again, we become like predictable and we lose the ability to be creative. So I just wanted to know if you had thoughts on like how we simultaneously, or also like tools for interacting with people and like ways to bring what you're talking about into conversations and how we simultaneously like retain the lessons of the past and encourage spontaneity and innovation. Yeah, how we balance those things.
Yes, as someone who is somewhat intellectual and often worried, I totally agree. You have to get out of that space. So this was a really interesting conversation. My name's Savith, by the way. My question to you is, within your own lives, how do your professional lives, I see Kazembe at so many protests and activist meetings, and as a professor, how do these lives play off your art making? What gives life to what, I guess, is my question. So, yeah.
Hi, my name is Sheila. I don't know, I was on an airplane and I saw this really horrible movie called Annie. It's a new version of Annie. I don't know if anyone else has seen it, but it's the, you know, Annie with the, little orphan Annie, but now she's black. She's a very cutesy little girl. And there's a scene in the movie which is supposed to be spontaneous. I know it's not, but she gets like a whole classroom of kids to be, do like a series of rhythms using their hands, clapping, and using their feet. And I'm wondering if there's, when you're doing, if you're improv, if there's some way for you to engage the entire room as a rhythm section.
Thanks. And I'm really interested to hear this because I know you've been talking a lot lately about the issue of improvisation, right?
Yeah.
We follow each other on Facebook a lot. Mm-hmm, and so this whole discussion about what is improvisation.
Yeah.
I wanted to just offer a couple of reflections, and this is not so much from the jazz tradition, but from a different, you know, Afro diaspora tradition, which is rumba, right? And,
yeah.
and so, what? Which is all rumba,
yeah.
which is all about time,
yeah, yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And so this interplay, it works because you have this a basic rhythmic structure, and people sort of know the form, and then within that, there's a tremendous amount of freedom. So the relationship between form and freedom, but also the role of collectivity, because it also doesn't work if it's just a bunch of guys banging on drums and everybody sort of doing their solo. You need the singing, you need dancing, and the music, otherwise it's sort of not complete. But then there's also a way in which the space, I was thinking about what you had said about sort of the space of the performance, that also, even if the music doesn't happen exactly, but people are there and there's this intent and there's this sense of community. And so this, I was thinking about the idea of community and communitas, in terms of politics, in terms of political action, and thinking about so this current, you know, the protests, what's different and what's the same about the protests now and protests of the past, and this, and I don't think that it's not important to have an objective, but it's also the pleasure of being there and invoking this sense of community, the beingness. Mm. And the way in which I think we in the left very often don't articulate or create spaces, which is our beingness, our togetherness. And I wouldn't frame it exactly in a religious sense, but how do we, in fact, as a left, invoke, create spaces for collective being, for communitas, for pleasure? And I was thinking about this in relationship, so I went from the United States to this series of protests that have been going on for the last 13 weeks, pretty incredibly, 14 weeks in Guatemala against the government.
And
which takes a lot from, and people are wearing anonymous masks, right? And they're taking very much some from the performative style of the recent protests in the United States, although it has its very own sense of being. But the collective pleasure of being in the space of the space of the protest as a space of communitas. So this is just a couple of things that I wanted to, I guess, sort of throw out, you know, for thinking. And then also this, you know, the idea of, I think, invoking a sense of self that is a non-individualistic self. And that also, I think, is very strong in still in many indigenous communities in Guatemala, where people don't only see themselves, still don't, and I don't want to like romanticize and say indigenous people, you know, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. But to think about also the ways that do we draw upon and that can we draw upon that in our left traditions of invoking senses of the self that are collective selves. How do we imagine collective ways of being without erasing the individual? But how can the individual be, in fact, an I in the we or a we in the I?
Hi, I'm Jim, and in 2008 I started something called the Aaron Burr Society because he shot and killed our first capitalist, Alexander Hamilton.
Right.
And I started performing on Wall Street, and I eventually, very quickly went out and bought a horn and took some lessons because I wanted to get more attention. And of course, you don't need a permit to have a horn. If you have amplification, you need a permit. Mm-hmm. So I started playing, and you know, eventually Occupy Wall Street happened, and I continued to play. And it's been really interesting to be able to work with different people and to bring this to different events and to be a part of it on a different way and be able to contribute in a way. Sometimes, you know, I would be helping to organize, but at other times I would just come and contribute the sound to go with the protests and chants and things like that, mm-hmm. and improvisation with different musicians who had showed up. It's a very empowering feeling to just be a part of that and kind of lose yourself into that. And I know that's what you're talking about on one level, on a different level than what I do. I'm more of a visual artist. I've only played a few years. But the idea of what improvisation gives you as an individual, I think is really amazing.
Hi. I wanted to ask about from where Lisa had left off in a way, or from a different angle. I mean, Marx said that the tradition of all the dead generations weighs like a nightmare. On the brains of the living.
Brains of the living.
Right.
Yes.
And so in that context, in a capitalist culture like ours, can you actually say that there is some sort of fundamental self that is not socialized or that is not, you know, permeated with everything from the culture that can then be put out by itself free or through improvisation or through, I mean, or are we just, not only just, but are we reproducing even through that form some of our own socialization even as we use these different forms? And same thing politically, as other people had talked about the political forms as well. So then how does, you know, is it utopian that way? Yes, it's natural in us. Yes, we can utopianly put out a true self. Or is there a different angle? I'm getting lost philosophically in that, as I often do. But is there a more dialectical or more Marxist approach to how we see these things integrated rather than the true self to be expressed?
My name's Jim. I recently attended a conference at Columbia on the Harlem Renaissance. They had a two-day conference, which was really interesting. And one of the things that struck me listening to this, you know, they were going back, you mentioned Tin Pan Alley, they're going back beyond Tin Pan Alley. And what struck me was every period of immense social change, you will see reflected in art, improvisation. At the time of the French Revolution, the idea of the mainstream theater was broken by 1790, immediately as the revolution occurred. You can look after the First World War. Dadaism just springs to mind as a form. And forget about the 60s. The 60s was embodied with improvisation. Yes. So I think there's a really, when you have artistic aesthetic norms broken apart in any kind of period of time, improvisation will spring forward as one of the strains coming out historically around the world, as far as I can see. And I wonder what we're seeing now in terms of art. You know, what kind of situation is reflective of that or not? Because then the question is, how does it manifest itself in consciousness or not? Because we know in the 60s, all that improvisation got, you know, subsumed by capitalism really fast. Hippie capitalism, advertising, whoop, took it right in. So I wonder what kind of phase we're in right now as a society with the kind of improvisation we see. Because inherently, I was trained as a musician. Inherently, musicians love to improvise. You know, it's in their genes to do that. But I'm just wondering what you guys think in general about art form and the relationship of that to change.
I think...
Hi, I'm Michael. One last thing. I remember when this group, three of you, was being brought together, and the title, as it is in our intensive program, and as Kaz came up with it, is "The Streets Are Polyphonic." And I just, there was something that resonated besides polyphony. The title just made me feel great inside when Kaz came up with it. And going through what everyone here has said, there is that aspect. There, I mean, we're all nervous speaking in front of one another to one greater or lesser degree, but there is something really wonderful about how we are expressing ourselves. When Lewis first spoke, this vision or this aura hit me of how it's interesting that in this digital era, there are these services like Spotify, Pandora, with the relational databases of music that you can plug onto your computer or any type of electronic device, and you can get, you pick some kind of music you like, and other songs or rhythms will come up based on something that the digital barons of today have devised. And that it's interesting, but it never has the, I mean, what struck me is I had this picture when Lewis was speaking of a DJ being so much better. And for one thing, the DJ is there with an audience and is in the moment and can be so much better than a relational database will ever be. Yet we do have these challenges before us of capital, even in the images that it tries to convince us to buy products with, they have figured out the motions of improvisation or of being spontaneous. You see the ads are getting more and more sophisticated. They actually, with disgusting messages, there are moments that make us have recognitions because capital has found the need for us to, they reach us in the same way of the polyphonic or the poly images that come before us. In any case, I don't want to speak beyond this. My solo is done right now. But what a great, I don't know how we follow up from this panel. Mm-hmm. To me, it's a great way to start our intensive. And thank all three of you very much.
Yeah. You know what? Yeah, the questions was like jazz, you know, because they're all related. You know, they might have been coming from different spaces in a way. But I was thinking about answers, and the answers is sort of like a thread running through all of them almost. I'll make it brief so Professor Gordon can expound on it and Professor Kazembe. But I would say that the changes in what was happening socially was parallel with the changes in the music for sure. Like you said, even bebop, which is called mainstream music, it had more structure than so-called free jazz, but it was still a social reaction to racism in that it was musicians mastering music on a certain level of Western classical music in a very hard way, which was a declaration of intellect at a very intense time period when that music was created in particular, and the sort of imagery of black people on the screen at the time. The word bebop doesn't really do it a lot of justification, but the music itself, the fact that it was based on mastering music on such a level was a statement saying, you know, we're not these people that you see on the screen, you know, chasing chickens or whatever, and stuff like that. And even more so with the so-called free jazz avant-garde of the 60s, that was definitely parallel with what was happening politically. The more the barriers of political speech opened up, there began to be less barriers. It happened with the music. And it's really not new, which goes back to what the sister here who just wrote the book said about we started it. Because there's a lot of that in the jazz world, too. I've been coming across a lot of that. And, you know, I have varying degrees of patience with it, but no, you didn't. You can contribute things that are new to what people started. You know, you can bring your voice to it, but you have to realize that it's part of a totality. And a lot of the egoism that you mentioned is really based on not the subsequent generations knowing what they're supposed to know in a way, because they didn't feel that they had to, you know. And somehow some individuals have claimed jazz in its earlier states. They've tried to make a conservative thing out of it, you know, as if Duke Ellington or Bird and Diz were going to vote for Giuliani or something. I mean, but, you know, jazz, as long as it existed, was a statement of, was a social statement. With everything in life involved in it, you know, but ultimately in all its forms. So whatever's mainstream is not really mainstream, it's still relevant, even if a newer style came along. Me, as a free jazz or avant-garde player, what I do is still very informed by, I don't view myself as separate from jazz, even though sometimes what I can play is very different. But I like playing in different contexts. Like me and Professor Gordon, before we spoke, played some jazz standards. And, you know, it wasn't contrived. It wasn't being done to say I am playing a standard. It's like we really feel that as a force, even if we feel other things as well like that. And I think what you were saying about young people and the arrogance, I think there's goes back to also what you were saying about a lot of the music that they pumped in the community on purpose to dumb down the cognitive processes of the black working class. Because, you know, as powerful as the state is and the power that they have, I do believe that they were caught off guard for a second. So they probably vowed to fight back through music, you know, through warfare, through music, through negative imagery, thinking like an adolescent, like you said. And now we have this war on the public schools with parents who are blaming the public schools and public school teachers for not, quote unquote, being good, when the reality is they themselves are immersed in the pop culture with the children. And that time period where the parents were able to sit down and debrief the children from things and teach them, you know, they're listening to Beyonce with the kids and don't have anything to teach them. So everything else is everybody else's fault. The schools are bad, the teachers are bad, et cetera, et cetera. When we're really, the cultural and political information is not what it should be in that regard. So we're dealing basically with warfare through art. On young people, on young black minds, you know, you preparing them through pumping the stupid music in the community, and then you take the housing, and, you know, it's a whole process. So, and jazz musicians were very involved in social movements and doing things for different organizations for a long time, even blatantly, especially in the 50s. Lumbe Brath and the African Jazz Arts Society, which is sort of the forerunner to the black arts movement in Harlem. They were doing things with jazz musicians in Harlem for a long time. which was the precursor to what Baraka and Larry Neal and A.B. Spellman were to do later. I think they just did it with different styles of music. I think Baraka and the Black Arts Group were probably more inclined toward free jazz along with bebop, which is probably the only difference. But the intent was the same, to say that jazz is intertwined with what's happening socially. And I myself have always been inspired by that kind of activity as an organizer of music performances, as a current teacher in training, and as a jazz musician, and just being inspired by the Black Arts Movement in general. What I do comes directly from that kind of activity and from witnessing cultural centers like the East in Brooklyn, which people are starting to talk about now. I mean, I was just a child at that time, but I was there with my father often. He used to play there a lot with different people. But even though I was young, I remember the energy level, and I remember some very cutting-edge music being played right in the community. So later on, when the line came along about what the black working class could or couldn't understand, I mean, I knew personally that wasn't true. I mean, like and dislike, yes, you know, because like I, you know, said a little while ago, it's also wrong to condescend to somebody if they don't like avant-garde things like that, as if this they don't have the same kind of political consciousness you do. I mean, both problems are parallel with each other. But yeah.
I think Cassandra wants to say something.
Yeah, I agree with Ross. There's some really, like, really powerful questions, and you know, I'm gonna tackle just a few of them. First, in terms of like the Communist Party and like jazz, you can read some really great books. The three that come to mind are Michael Denning's book on the Cultural Front, where he talks about the involvement of folks like Duke Ellington and James Johnson in regards to the anti-fascist musicals. You know, like Jump for Joy.
Yes.
Actually, James Johnson, who's a well-known pianist, you know, wrote this anti-lynching play, anti-fascist play. The Cultural Front is one of my favorite books.
Yeah.
I would say that. The other book I would say is Mark Nazion's book on the communists in Harlem.
Yeah.
That was published, I think, in like Grove Press. Mm-hmm. And the third one is actually a book that by this Communist Party theoretician. It's not widely read, but it's called Jazz, A People's Music by Sidney Finkelstein. All those three are available in print, and they will tell you the history of jazz and the left and the popular front. In terms of the other question, science fiction, absolutely, like it's something that really also is inspiring. I think it's a corollary. I hope next year we're able to talk about that. But what that really brought up for me is also the fact of like the way in which writers like, you know, Ursula Le Guin and like Octavia Butler really dealt with ideas of gender in terms of leadership, you know, and also one of the things that we don't talk about is that oftentimes like jazz is a very male-centered space in terms of who gets to perform. But I think that what we're talking about is transferred over to science fiction. You also talk about queering in that space. And there's also ways in which, you know, that, you know, a certain level of sensitivities in terms of the ways music can open up. You know, Hazel Carby has this great essay about Miles Davis and queerness in this book called Race Men, you know, which is really good to read because the ways in which Miles Davis had this very ambiguous, soft tone to his trumpet, you know, suggested a type of femininity that, you know, and a type of eroticism that's really core. In terms of like the young people and like the organizing, like I hear you, sis. Like I consider myself a young elder. Like I'm somebody who's like in between, like, you know, people who've done my political training from who come out of the Black Panther Party, come out of like, you know, different liberation movements. And also, so I have a foot in that world, but I also have a foot in what's going on now. And one thing I really kind of appreciate is something that Lewis brought up, is a question of eldership and mentorship. You know, we're operating in this context of like post-crack, you know, and also a time where like tremendous amounts of like generational memory has been lost to the prison industrial complex in the drug war. So part of the work of like revolutionary organizing is to rebuild and reclaim that. And so on a very low level, like, you know, I'm very worried and like I'm very concerned around things like Black Twitter, which, you know, we can have an entire conversation around that. But what's funny about Black Twitter to me is the role of kitsch, which is kind of like a kind of mass-produced nostalgia that becomes a holding point for history. So things that, you know, were holding points for revolutionary activity, you know, people making references to Good Times. You know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. like, you know, like, and Good Times is a great show. I love it. It's funny. But I think that there's a way in which that particular space illustrates the necessity of like a particular type of historical intervention. On the other hand, I am like really excited about people like Kendrick Lamar, who has an album called Pimp a Butterfly. His main musical contributor was a guy by the name of Kamasi Washington,
yeah.
who comes directly out of the kind of like yeah. Horace Top Scott,
yes.
you know, Los Angeles collective
exactly.
jazz
exactly.
scene. So when you listen, the album is called To Pimp a Butterfly by Kendrick Lamar, and his musical director is Kamasi Washington, who comes out of this Los Angeles scene.
Yeah.
Also D'Angelo's music, which I really think is really important in terms of like really opening up and really responding to this like kind of Black Lives moment. Another point that I want to mention to like Sava's point and also to Lisa's point, you know, like what keeps me alive and what keeps me going on is the fact that like I've been trying to figure out a way of like talking about like what my politics are right now, and oftentimes I'm very much like I've been going with like Black radical tradition for such a long time, but I feel like sometimes it's a little devious because like unless you really understand what that really means, like it's hard to understand what that really means. So a lot of people call themselves like you know what I'm saying, like so like I feel like a lot of people call themselves Black radicals, but like don't really want to engage with the issues that are what Black radicalism really means. I started calling myself a socialist, a S-O-U-L, socialist, that thinking about the issue of soul and where soul is at in terms mm-hmm. of a collective process, mm-hmm. and that's where I'm at. So like I'm in my church,
yeah,
I'm here. Yeah, no, it's not copyright. It's here. It's yours. If y'all want it, if you don't want it, that's cool. But that's the way I feel about stuff. Cause like you know, it's not so much about me. It's not so much about a specific ideology, but like something that Lisa said that I think resonates. Something that Gina Dent said that really hits me is collective joy versus individual pleasure. You know, saying so where there's special spaces of collective joy, I really want to go to those places, and that's where it nourishes. The work, you know, so I'll just leave it at that.
Well, thanks for the questions. They're fabulous. I have a bunch of things to say, and so I hope you don't mind. The first thing is, in terms of, is it Daryl or Dar? Yeah, Daryl. Daryl, in a way, raised an important question, which is something that is often overlooked, particularly in political and revolutionary thought, which is the importance of not being boring.
Yes.
Okay? I mean, in effect, that's what your point's about. And the you know, I mean, there the mentions of great thinkers that many people overlook because you're too busy thinking of the thinker is great without looking at the work.
Mm.
But great work is genuinely interesting. And it's not just at the level of the content of the ideas, but the transmission of them, the writing, you know. You know something's happening when you want to read it out loud, okay? Now, I bring this up for a variety of reasons, and just very, very quickly, in terms of the question, it's that we're connecting in terms of jazz musicians in the Communist Party. It was not only jazz musicians, but folk musicians as well. Harry Belafonte is an example of this, in terms of decisions of what he wanted to do. Which is ironic, of course, because the first platinum album was performed by Harry Belafonte, a communist. You know, it's the first million selling album. It's really, yeah. Right. It was the one with Dale and all of it. And these songs are all revolutionary songs about workers.
A Chicago Black Renaissance.
Yeah. Correct. But a lot of people don't know this, but 40% of the Communist Party in the United States was black.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there are these other elements that a lot of people don't pay attention to, because a lot of the others in the party were not only from other brown groups, but even among those who are white, quite a few also, as we know, were Eastern Europeans immigrants. And it was also, you know, among the things that scared J. Edgar Hoover was not just communism, but the fact that the Communist Party was a place of de facto miscegenation. Mm-hmm. You know, there are all these red diaper babies. It's absolutely true. I mean, a lot of people didn't bring this out, but one of the real, it's pretty obvious why, for instance, Clinton didn't support Lonnie Guinier.
Mm.
You know, a lot of people, you know, he publicly said, well, he doesn't agree with her
mm-hmm.
position on rights. You know, neoliberalism says individual rights.
Mm-hmm.
She argued for group rights.
Right.
Lonnie Guinier.
Yeah.
She was up for Attorney General. The Republicans argued against it. She was a red diaper baby.
Mm-hmm. That's so, the first black president sold out.
Now, she was a red diaper baby. And it was more important for him for the debate to be against a philosophical question of group rights versus, if they looked further into her, could you imagine the Republican Party would have said about Clinton electing a red diaper baby to be the Attorney General? But the thing I start with that to bring up several things. The first thing is some of the questions pertain to a problem that I'm going to come back to, which is, you see, if you think about the goal of pushing capitalism, let's just start with a premise that one of the ways people are duped is for the anthropology that supports capitalism to assert itself not as an anthropology, but as the anthropology. You see, if you look at almost all arguments mm-hmm. for capitalism, they're in human nature arguments.
Mm-hmm.
They're saying
mm-hmm.
that they're the ways human beings really are.
Yeah.
Now, of course, if that's the way human beings really are, why so much effort to persuade us? Do you see what I'm getting? Why was someone's writing, so many things to tell you you're really selfish, to tell you you're really, you know, you see what I'm getting at? And so already there's something amiss, right? There's something, some form of mystification going on. The second thing that we have to pay attention to is the goal of it is to make it complete. And to make it complete would mean that education has to be yoked to that anthropology, which is kind of LaRose's question, but also politics has to be yoked to that anthropology. Now, the reason I bring that up is because we're living in a very strange period. We're living in a period of literally not simply, you see, intellectuals historically, if you look at a Gramscian critique of how intellectuals work, intellectuals historically are supposed to those who are able to create a critique of a situation, which means you're not subsumed in it, you're not yoked to it, but you're able to raise the question of distinction. Well, that makes intellectuals then dangerous. So one has to de-intellectualize intellectuals by yoking them to the logic of that economy.
Mm.
So what you have then are two forms of commodification.
Mm-hmm.
To do it, one has to make intellectual work itself a commodity, you see? In other words, something in sales and exchange. And then within it, because you want to now de-intellectualize it, you need to de-link its relationship to politics, so you need to depoliticize it paradoxically through the commodification of politics. So if you notice today, for instance, this is connected to your point, there are people who offer as a commodity their political identity. You may notice many people are more interested in not in what you argue politically, not in what you do politically, but what you say your political identity is.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see what I'm getting at?
Mm-hmm.
And that now brings you then into the subsumption or the yoking or the commodification of politics.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this begins to raise some very crucial issues that we have to back up a little to look at what we're talking about here, okay? The first one, of course, is if we're talking about improvisation, the most of the conversation has been around aesthetic improvisation. Because you see, there are forms of improvisation that have nothing to do with aesthetics. For instance, remember MacGyver, right? That's, you know, I'm able to do that because I notice that we're a fairly mature audience. So we'll remember some of these shows. But this is about technocratic or technological improvisation. And in many ways, that is what expert, if you're an expert, just period, in anything, before you get to any the other dimensions, you, if you are a genuine expert, should be able to act extemporaneously. You should be able to improvise. You know you have a good plumber if the plumber shows up and says, oh man, there's a problem here. I don't have the right stuff in the truck, but we can do something and we figure it out. Then you know you have a good plumber if it's like, yo man, shut it down, we'll order the parts, see you next week, get another plumber, okay? The other thing you know if you have a good plumber is every good plumber will explain each detail because the plumber is not trying to dupe you, but knows that you can appreciate the job that's done if you're a competent consumer or you're a competent person being helped. And this is the same with medicine, right? It's not that the physician touches you and heals you, which is the mystical. A good physician, yeah, teaches you to learn how to make yourself healthy. And this is how it links to freedom. The plumber is trying to get you to have an independent relationship to the material, right, maintenance of your home. So you know what a real, or you could prevent what could be an emergency situation. Now, I bring these up precisely because, you see, improvisation, as we know, at the level of social mechanism, there's no such thing as a society that does not face catastrophes, crises, and so forth. And if they lack the capacity for improvisation, that society's in deep trouble. Now, this begins to connect to some other issues. And so that's the first. But now let's move to the aesthetic improvisation. Now, one of the things that become rather interesting and what creates problems in a lot of Marxist thought has been through a failure to appreciate the aesthetic category. This is where you see the difference between, for instance, particularly the difference between black Marxism and say, let me just pick Frankfurt School critical theory Marxism.
Mm-hmm.
Because Adorno, Horkheimer, those individuals, they looked at these issues predominantly in terms that look at the aesthetics as that which need to be put under control.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't like jazz, precisely because jazz challenged that presupposition of control. Now, this is where, right? Before I get to it, I want to bring up something because you notice I brought up the point about a political anthropology. When I wrote Fanon, the Crisis of European Man, I had a chapter where I talked about this issue. There are many revolutionaries who speak as if simply supplying the physical conditions would actually facilitate the revolutionary environment. And so they stand perplexed at a world in which people are suffering. Oh, do I have to stop right now? Okay. A world in which people are suffering even though they got food and shelter. Why do people suffer even if they have food and shelter? Now, the answer to this is pretty straightforward. It's because the purpose of a revolution is not simply to create something as we do in a zoo where there would just simply be food and shelter for the animal. The purpose of a revolution is to create a human world. And the human world is a symbolic world of interaction of in which one is actually producing an environment that's what's called livable.
Mm-hmm.
Now, livability is why, for instance, everyone in this room, when you got your first apartment or your home, you decorate. If you think about it, what does that have to do with dwelling. Because what you're doing is transforming a space into a place. A place is a livable human world. You bring music into that world because music is part of the human world and with its meanings. You bring in paintings, you see what I'm getting at? All these aesthetic productions, dancing. Why do human beings dance? You see? Now, when you bring all these things together, what you're beginning to do in the process is the constitution of human world. Now, and now I have to just, I'll have to go a tiny bit over time because this is something I have to bring up that could give you the connection that's connected to a lot of these questions. I went last week to see a production of the play Here. You know, you remember Here?
Yeah.
Yeah. And it was fascinating because, of course, Here has to be performed by young people. This is what I'm thinking, right? It has to be. It would be very weird to see a production of Here with our group.
Yeah.
You know, it just won't work. You know, I'm saying the actors have to be very young. Now, of course, but of course, it's very funny because today, nutrition, other factors, people are going to gyms. Young people look different today than they did in the 60s. But so they're trying their best to do this play. Now, what was fascinating when I watched the play Here and looked at the politics, the performance, everything, the sex, all of that that's going on in there, you notice something very peculiar. Because, you see, this is a play about young people in the 60s. And a lot of people don't ask, what was different about young people in the 60s versus young people in 2015? Well, one of the things that struck me when I looked at the play Here, as, you know, I'm enjoying the music and everything. If you think about the play Here, first you have to go back to the 50s. And in the 50s, there were several things going on. It was a world in which, for instance, people were actively thinking about nuclear devastation. It's a world in which there was drumming up hysteria, and I'm talking about from the US point of view, about communism. And within it, it was a lot like a witch hunt, but it was a world in which there was such a notion of a private realm, because everybody knows when you go and actually study the 50s, a whole lot of sex and drugs and all of that were going on. All of that was going on in the 50s, but it was behind closed doors. What the 60s was the cathartic bubbling up of that, because it was there, but it was without freedom. It bubbled out and made its way into the public sphere as an expression of freedom. And that's why you had people, everybody, it was not just the hippies, a lot of people, nobody thinks of the 60s without thinking of large groups in public. The drugs were being taken in public, the protests were always very public, the sex was public, everything was public. And even in the 70s, right afterwards, they were still dealing with the notion of public. It's just it got pretty cold and disco took it into discos, but it was still everybody there. Why I bring this up is that freedom was manifested there as bringing things out. You see what I'm getting at? And the theories of power that were at work, power, if you look at a lot of the logic of things that were being argued for, even in a lot of the political writings, even in the neo-Marxist political writings, they were about trying to understand how to make the future happen. This is crucial because conservatism is always saying the appeals to a mythic perfect past.
Mm-hmm.
So conservatism is always about return.
Right.
Old style leftism, but let's just say all revolutionary thought says the present is imperfect and the past wasn't perfect. Which means, of course, you have to bring in the new. But the problem in bringing in the new is that if you're bringing it in, it means that it's going to be expressed in aesthetic productions that say unequivocally that you can do what, you can create that which could be otherwise. You see what I'm getting at? And if it could be otherwise, it means you're even more responsible for what is created, which means you have to have a theory of maturation in which you take responsibility for that future. Now, here's the big shift. Look at the world we're in today, and you see the immediate shift. Young people today, and this is connected to a lot of, but it was what happened in between is after the 70s, you know, there was Reagan. Neoconservatism says order is what matters above all. And under a regime of order, and we, all of that's connected to the police state, it shifts from the state in which even the question of law enforcement was about protection. It shifted it to the question of punishment, but precisely because it is to curtail the behavior and create order. Now, why is this crucial? Because you see, the fundamental aspect of neoconservatism is about control. And if you look at neoliberalism, neoliberalism believes in the market, but when it appeals to individual rights, it now makes control the individual self-control. Do you see what I'm getting at? If you look at a lot of young people today, here's a fundamental problem. Many young people today think power is about control. Do you see what I'm getting at? If you look at the 60s young people, it was about letting go of control. And that's why sexuality was communal. Everything was communal. And in other words, because sex itself is not simply the agency decision to be with another, but in being with another to be willing to let go. You see what I'm getting at? If you look at contemporary sexuality among young people, for instance, they think agency and control are the same thing. But you can actually be in control, but don't manifest your agency. And it is possible to manifest agency without controlling all the conditions. And that's because what an adult sensibility understands is that you can be responsible in circumstances where you don't control the entire circumstance. Now, this becomes a shift because, you see, if you are to be in control in advance, how can you grow? And this, because precisely the educational circumstance is one in which you have to admit you do not control the outcomes and that you have to have a relationship with someone to help you grow. So that example you gave was a prime example because of what happens if you shift to a neoconservatism, an order premised upon control. Means then, if you cannot grow, now you have the classic, what I call, abuse situation. Because if nobody can relate to you, how do you get to abuse people? You get to abuse people by making them, cutting off from them the ability to communicate with others that they're being abused. And so you now have isolated young people who think they control everything, and what they're actually become now are controlled consumers. And that affects a lot of models. And you already know as a professor, it means education moves away from flourishing the cultivation and establishment of relationships simply to how to manage consumers who are to be in control of themselves, which means they're expected to enter the educational environment and exit it the exact same way they were from the beginning. In other words, no growth. The revolution, all revolution is about growth. Revolution is about understanding what you need not only to get rid of, but also what you have to be in a relationship with in order to set the conditions for the future. And that becomes something radically different, and it connects to improvisation in a very important way because it means the aesthetic and the pragmatic conceptions of improvisation cannot be delinked. Because the aesthetic part is to make sure what the pragmatic part does is to create a livable world. Okay.
We're taking our dinner break now and we're coming back here at 7:30.
Okay. Thank you. Well, we could do a little jam now if you like.
What time is it?
What time is it?
Oh. What time is it now?
Okay.
I think it's.
Yeah. What's
your name? Lewis. Lewis Gordon. Yeah, pleasure.
Great discussion. Oh, yeah, yeah. Thanks for coming, man. Yeah. Yeah, Cass. Thank you, too.
Hey, Rob. That's cool. Thanks. So, you know, we've
That's for your Met session.
What's that?
You go here. The stream?
Yeah.